Hi, this is Larry Graham, and you're listening to the Peach and Black Podcast.
Welcome to the Peach and Black Podcast, your central place to hear unofficial news, reviews, trivia, and intelligent discussion on all things happening in the Prince world. Featuring the hosts, MC.
You know, it's got all those classic Prince elements.
Captain.
Why wouldn't you just record as much as you could?
Player.
It's just like a storage house of ideas.
Toe Jam.
Either version. I love both versions.
Hello, 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 and welcome back to the Peach and Black Podcast. Joining me, as always, on this virtual round table are Player.
Boom shakalakala boom.
Captain.
I gotcha.
And Toe Jam.
I think Toe Jam's, he's got like a gig on today. I think he said he was going to come. We just got to wait for him.
Oh, that's right. He's doing a show in Brisbane.
Yeah. When he comes in, we'll just put him in.
All right. I'm looking at the clock now. He should be here any minute anyway. So,
yeah, you're right.
Okay.
Let's get into it.
For all of our listeners, Toe Jam will be back. All right. Thanks for joining us all again. And today we've got a special episode for you. It's not an album review. It is an interview with a very, very, very special guest. He is an American baritone singer, a musician, a songwriter, and record producer. He is best known as the bass guitar player in the popular and influential soul funk band Sly and the Family Stone, and as the founder and frontman of Graham Central Station. He is credited with the invention of the slapping technique.
Thumping and plucking.
Well, I was about to say that, the technique which radically expanded the tonal palette of the bass, although he himself refers to the technique, just as Captain just pointed out, as thumping and plucking, and that was a very brief excerpt from Bass Player Magazine, 2007 issue. It is, of course, Mr. Larry Graham.
Woo!
And I, for one, have to just say this. There's bass before Larry Graham and bass after Larry Graham. He's not only one of the world's best, but also one of the world's most important and influential bass players and, in fact, musicians of all time. Ain't no doubt about it. We are fired up in this special tour edition of the Peach and Black Podcast featuring Larry Graham. So, folks, get ready. Strap yourselves in, hold on to your wigs, and release yourself as we interview Larry about Graham Central Station, Prince, his latest record, Raise Up, and, of course, his upcoming tour of Australia when Larry and the band are going to be throwing down the funk on the following dates, April 18 and April 19 at Byron Bay Bluesfest, April 20th and 21st at the infamous The Basement in Sydney, and April 23rd, rounding out their Australian tour at the Corner Hotel in Melbourne. It's going to be something special. Something big is coming, folks.
It's going to be one in a million.
It's going to be, well, this is an unmissable one in a million show, I'll tell you that much. And for everyone who is listening from Sydney and Melbourne, and in particular, anyone who has tickets to Larry's Sydney and Melbourne shows, keep listening and make sure you stay tuned for details on a big surprise towards the end of the show. And with that, of course, let's start it off with the main man. Mr. Larry Graham is in the building.
Hello.
Larry.
How are you?
Very well.
Hey.
How are you doing?
I'm doing wonderful. How about yourself?
Doing fantastic.
Who do I have?
Well, you've got me, MC, the host. You've got Player.
Hey, thanks for your time, Larry.
Oh, you're more than welcome.
And Captain.
Hello, Larry.
What's up, Captain?
I'm here. Hey. I'm ready to do this.
Oh, it's a pleasure to meet all of you.
You too. We'll see you when you get here, though, in person.
Oh, yeah, we're looking forward to it.
So you're coming to Australia in April.
It's coming up quick, so we are very excited.
Have you been rehearsing?
Oh, we always plan.
Okay. I guess that's what you do.
That's what we do.
Okay.
That's what we do.
But is the band in Minneapolis, or are they or on the West Coast?
No, my whole band is in Oakland, which is my original hometown. So okay. my whole band currently lives in Oakland.
I mean, rehearsals are one thing, but what about the set lists? Have you been thinking about the set list for these upcoming shows? And, you know, how much does playing in a faraway place like Australia, you know, what kind of influence does that have on the set list?
Well, I played there before. I came there with Prince one time.
Yeah, I remember that. I was there that night.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And so I kind of got a little taste of what to expect. And long before that, I came to Australia and spent about a week there, my wife and I and daughter. It wasn't for playing, though. We just came and hung out for about a week, and that was fun. So this will be my third trip to Australia, so...
Okay.
It's not an entirely new adventure, so I kind of got a feel for the people, and so all that helps.
Yeah.
And then I get, you know, speaking to you and other folks, I get input from you too, and that all helps, you know, shape my show and, you know, the direction I choose to go in.
Mm-hmm. And how much do you improvise on the night?
That has a lot to do with it too, because so many times I'll write out a set list, and it'll just change. You know, we'll get on stage, and sometimes maybe 50% of it will be, or even sometimes more, will just be different. And it depends, you know. Sometimes I like to play off the audience a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm really a people person, so I like to get a feel for the audience, and you know, so sometimes I'll stick pretty much to the set list, but sometimes I'll just go way off the set list.
Yeah.
Yeah. I like to leave room for that, you know.
Just kind of see what happens.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's very refreshing to hear that and to witness that kind of show in 2014, you know, because so much of the music that a lot of the current artists that put on shows these days, it's all kind of pre-programmed and sequenced. And I think it maybe lacks a little bit of that fresh energy that you guys bring. And I remember a show about 3 years ago at North Sea Jazz in Rotterdam that you and Graham Central Station did. Man, that was some experience. I mean, I was just, I think my jaw was to the floor for the majority of that show. It was just... I mean, you were doing things with the bass and to the bass that I didn't know was was possible. It was an unbelievable experience, you know. And
thank you.
We're really looking forward to seeing you guys in Australia.
I remember that show. That was a fun show. It was a lot of that was spontaneous too.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it was crazy. You guys, you started by walking through the crowd and, you know, all the, with the whole band and on percussion, I think. And it was, it was pretty wild.
You know what I really, really like is a lot of our shows now, I would say the majority of our shows, a lot of parents bring their kids to our shows for the very reason you mentioned. A lot of shows you go to, it's kind of pre-recorded or you're lip-syncing and it's not really live music, you know, with musicians up there playing live. And, you know, a lot of kids don't get a chance to experience that. And so a lot of our shows, we see parents and their kids at the shows together, like the parents are saying, and this is what I was raised up on. This is, you know, this is musicians. And, you know, we try to always encourage young folks to, it's okay to sample and sequence and stuff like that, but know how to play your instrument too. You got options, you know. And
yeah,
then that way you'll be able to be the creator of new music as opposed to just relying on, you know, what's been done.
Yeah, and I mean, and there's also something about listening to you guys live that really, it really can't be beat. And I mean, the new album or your latest album, Raise Up, sounds incredibly energetic and live anyway. And we were hoping to ask you a little bit about that later on, but
sure.
Nothing beats the live show experience, I think. So,
yes,
play them.
Yeah, Larry, you're the band leader and lead vocalist in GCS. It's kind of rare for a band, like a bass player, to be the front man. So what kind of preparation do you need to do that for that role for it to work so well?
Well, the preparation was done long ago. When I ended up on bass, really, that wasn't my intended instrument. I grew up playing guitar and drums and keyboards, and I took saxophone in school and just various instruments. And I really thought I was going to end up being a guitar player. That's what I was doing when I was starting at 11 years old, and wow. Cut my first record when I was 13. But I was on guitar. And then when my mother and I started working together, it was during that time that I switched over to bass and came up with my style of playing the bass. So that's why I say it was kind of set long ago, because I invented the way I play the bass. I never have to practice it. It's just the way I play.
It looks like it comes really naturally too.
Yeah. And the other thing is, you know, when my mother and I worked together, you know, playing in, you know, clubs and lounges every night, you know, 5-6 nights a week, and playing the bass became like second nature to me, where I don't have to think about it, you know. So when I play, I can concentrate on entertaining the crowd or concentrate on my singing and not just, you know, my playing, because that kind of like goes on automatic pilot, which is why I prefer to play, even though I have a 5-string, I prefer to play my 4-string because I don't have to think about it. It's just my third arm attached to my body, and I just, you know, just let it go.
Yeah.
You see a lot of musicians, though, they play their instrument, but you can have a really great guitarist, but then you try to get him to sing at the same time, not going to happen. You just can't do it.
It could be a challenge. Yeah, it can be a challenge. I've told some other bass players before, you know, just because they asked me, how do you do that? How do you play and sing and dance? And, you know, and I just explained, well, you already know how to play the bass, you know, so you can pretty much like not think about that too much, because if you overthink it, you know, next thing you know, you're confusing yourself, you know.
Yeah.
And sometimes you get psyched out right up front. You're saying that I can't do that, you know, or it's too hard. Well, if you think that, then you kind of like then lost the battle to start with.
Yeah.
You know, so it's you just can't think about it. You know, it becomes like second nature. Like when you get on a bicycle, you just ride. You know, you think more about where you're going, not the fact that, oh, I'm balancing myself and I'm going forward.
Yeah. You said before about, you know, the spontaneity of a live show and you take the interaction from the audience. Both myself and MC, I'll let MC ask the question though. about this track.
I knew this was coming, Captain. We have kind of a special request, not only on the show, but I think safe to say from some of the funkiest people in Australia that we know, there is one song of yours that we would all absolutely lose our minds over if you played it live.
Let me guess.
No pressure.
Let me guess. Is it from the Raise Up album?
No.
No.
No, it's an older one. Okay, is it...
It's only three letters.
Well, you pretty much ruined it now.
Three letters? Oh, I was giving it four letters. Now three. Pow.
Yep. Oh, yeah.
That's the one.
Yes.
That's got to be one of the funkiest, if not the funkiest song I've ever heard in my life. Oh, it's unbelievable.
Thank you. That was going to be my second guess. My first guess was the four-letter word, hair.
Oh, yeah. That's got to be in there too, though, right?
Yeah, that was going to be my first guess, and then my second guess was going to be Pow.
Oh,
yeah,
because a lot of the bass players like those.
So if you can play that, you'll make a lot of people happy. But I know I don't think you play it very often at all. It's not a constant,
you know,
in the set list.
Yeah, I play it sometimes. Usually, you know, when it's asked for, because when we have a limited amount of time on a show, I got to play sometimes the most, you know, popular songs, the one that people have heard the most from either my current album or from Sly and the Family Stone days or from Grand Central Station days or from my solo days, you know. But there are times where we are not under the clock. And we've been known to play 3 hours plus, and we get everything in there then.
I'll talk to the people at the basement and see what we can do about any time restrictions.
Yeah, sometimes we are in situations like that, you know.
Hmm.
And well, we, so, you know.
We'll see.
We might have to bring our PAL sign.
But I know PAL has been requested, so
keep that in mind. Speaking of the basement, you have played there before, and I remember that moment vividly because it was the first time that I actually was at a Prince show, and it was an after show that they did at the basement.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just remember, I mean, the whole...
That was the only time.
the whole show was great, but those last two numbers when... I can't remember who it was now, but somebody just held up this white bass and the whole place damn near lost their minds because nobody knew that you were there. And all of a sudden, you know, you just come up out of backstage, and I think you guys went into Alphabet Street first and then just tore the roof off the place with, Release Yourself. And I still remember that to this day, you and Prince were just jamming on those bass lines, and he was on guitar. And
yeah, I remember that. Yeah,
incredible moment, you know. So I wasn't sure whether you guys knew, but at that point in the show, when you came on stage, people stopped serving drinks. I mean, the whole all the bar staff and everyone working around the place just stopped what they were doing, and they were just eyes planted on what was going on, because that was an incredible moment.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, we had a ball. We had a great time there. And that's why I say I kind of got a little feel for, you know, Australian audience a little bit, and I'm grateful for that, you know. So, you know, I got a little preview of kind of what to expect.
Moving on to Raise Up a little bit, the album.
The album, uh-huh. The new album.
Yep. Can you tell us any interesting kind of behind-the-scenes stories about recording that album, that release?
Well, it was a lot of fun recording the album, because as you mentioned earlier, it has a live feel to it, and that's because a lot of it, you know, we recorded live, all playing at the same time, you know, in the studio together, and that has a certain advantage, you know, for certain songs, and we were able to do that on a number of the songs that are on Raise Up. So that's why it has that live feel. That's what I was going after. And we recorded part of it in Europe, part of it at Paisley Park, and here in Minnesota, and part of it in L.A. at Rafael Sadiq's studio. And so it was a lot of fun making it. But I think the thing that really I'm happy about the most is the fact that we were able to capture that live feel. It was so important to me.
You mentioned Rafael Sadiq. We're very big fans of Rafael, and we just want to know how that collaboration came about.
Well, Rafael... and his other members of his family, they were, you know, they all from Oakland too, and were raised up on my music, as was Prince.
Raised up.
And pretty much, yeah, raised up on GCS. And then they went back, like Prince did, and got more into Sly and the Family Stone. And so it was a natural connection there. It was just a matter of time before we would end up doing something together. But his whole family is very much into my music, so it was great. It was a lot of fun working with him.
When you get down here to Australia, are you playing a lot of songs from Raise Up, or just a few, or you can't give that secret away yet?
Well, what I plan to do at this point is, there are some people who are familiar with my music from Sly and the Family Stone, so I have to throw in some of that.
Yeah.
They're familiar with my early Graham Central Station albums, so I have to get into that too.
Yeah.
And then my solo career starting in the 80s, I have to get into some of that. And then my latest stuff, you know, from Raise Up. So I kind of got to combine everything, because there are people, the way it usually works, there are people at the shows that are familiar with some of all of what I've done. So I try to give them a little taste of all of it.
Okay, again, we'll talk to the basement. We'll try and get it longer time. You got to play as long as you can. There's a lot to cover.
The sequencing of the songs on that album also, I mean, the album sounds very organic, but it's almost like listening to a show with, you know, lots of dynamic energy. Was that a really conscious thing that you yourself put together?
Oh, definitely. You know, I wanted it to have that type of a feel. It's kind of like telling a story, you know, from the beginning to the end. And, you know, the intent of the music is to help people to raise up above whatever they're dealing with. You know, everybody's dealing with something in their personal life, family, or at work or in life in general, and they do various things to help them raise up above whatever it is they're dealing with. Read a good book, put on some good music, go to a movie. They'll do something to help themselves to raise up. And the intent was to put on this album and from the beginning to the end, just kick back and let it help you to raise up above, you know, whatever you're dealing with, which is the same intent when we do a show. That's the way I structure and design the show so that it has that feel, you know, like a story has been told, you know, with a conclusion, with a beginning, a body, and a great conclusion. So that's the way I try to structure the album. And so I'm glad you mentioned that, because that means to me that you heard that, you picked up on that.
Larry, raise up the actual song itself. Is that a Larry Graham song, or is it Prince written, like lyrically? And do you have any sort of stories about working in the studio with Prince on that track?
It's a Larry Graham song. I wrote it and had the pleasure of recording it, you know, with Prince at Paisley Park. So that was a treat.
Okay.
And we always connect well, you know, in the studio and on stage, because we know each other well. You know, we've been able to spend many, many, many hours together.
I suppose it'd be good when you play a show with him, because he knows all the songs. He knows all your songs.
Yes, he does. So backwards and forwards.
So are you planning on recording new GCS music, or are you going to, because it was a fair while between this latest album and the one before that.
Yeah, it was. And I'm always writing, you know, and recording, because that's what I do. I mean, it's kind of like a painter who likes to do artwork. He might paint a lot of pictures that no one will ever see, but he paints because that's what he loves to do. And I'm like that with writing. You know, I'm constantly writing all the time, and some songs maybe no one will ever hear, but so I'm constantly doing that. And then when I have songs that go together, like for the Raise Up album, that tells a complete story and they fit together.
Yeah.
And then, so in addition to the music, then I wanted everything else to be in place too, working with the right people, you know, and stuff. So everything was at the right time, you know.
So the next album will be whenever it's ready.
Whenever it's ready.
Which
is another thing. Yeah, because I'm not really under a contract, a record contract, anything. So when it's ready, it'll come. But I'm constantly always writing.
Yeah, we hear that from Prince too, so we're very patient fans.
Thank you.
Now, we have a fourth member on this show who couldn't make it today. He's a horn player, and he actually has a gig today, and he wanted us to ask you about some of your horn recordings, and he really wanted to know about your recordings with Tower Power in the 70s.
Oh, yeah, it was great working with those guys. That's another Oakland-based group, so, you know, we all know each other very well, so it was just a natural, you know, you need some horns, you call the best, Tower Power.
That's it. What can you tell us about your involvement with recording when you work with Betty Davis on that, I think it was 73, I think it was.
Yeah, Betty Davis, she's just an awesome person. I mean, she has influenced a lot of young girls who have become popular today. You know, she kind of was, as they say, ahead of her time, but she had a major influence on a lot of young ladies today, and excellent songwriter. And, you know, when she would come into the studio, she wasn't necessarily a musician herself, but she knew what she wanted.
Yeah.
And she could explain it to you in such a way, you know, that you know exactly what she's going for. And then when she hears it, it's like, yeah, that's it. That's it.
That's what I want.
yeah, exactly. You know, and she wouldn't just take any old thing. You know, it had to be what she was feeling in her head, you know. And so she was great in that respect. And another thing I really like about her is every time she would come into the studio, or when you see her on a daily basis, she was consistently up and always energetic and a very nice, positive person. You knew what you were going to be getting tomorrow, where with some artists, you know, you just don't know how it's going to be tomorrow. It was great today and grumpy tomorrow, but she was consistently always the same, you know. And so that made all the musicians feel comfortable, and I'm sure she got a lot more out of us by being that way than, you know, in any other kind of way.
And you want to be around positive people. That makes everyone feel better.
Well, exactly. And you can hear it in the music, you know, because it's happy music. It's up music. You can feel the energy and you can feel, you know, the positive vibe that's in the studio. You know, that comes out in the record.
You can hear it.
Yeah, which is why people still love that music to, you know, today.
Mm, still sounds great.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this year, if no one's mentioned it yet, I'm sure they have, this is the 40th anniversary of Release Yourself, the album. Which album of yours, out of all of them, which is I know you can't pick a favorite, but what are you most proud of?
Oh, that's a hard one. You know, you work so hard on each one, and it's not like having a child, because that's a human being, but it kind of...
Prince disagrees.
What's that?
Prince says all his songs are like children.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I'm saying it's not exactly like a child, which is a human, but it's a very similar feeling in that you kind of give birth to each album, and it does become, in a sense, like that kind of relationship. It has, it takes on its own personality. You know, my kids and my grandkids are different. You know, I love all of them equally, but they're all different. You know, one from the other. And my albums are like that. You know, the first album is totally different from Release Yourself, which is totally different from Ain't No Bout-A-Doubt It, you know, which is totally different later on when I got into my solo stuff, like One in a Million You. It's a totally different album, which is totally different than Raise Up, you know. So, you know, it's like a bunch of my little musical children, and I love them all.
Okay.
You were talking about those Graham Central Station records in the 70s. And, you know, a lot of people talk about Stevie Wonder's great period from the early 70s to the late 70s and Sly's great period and Prince's great period. But that stretch is really unbelievable. Your GCS stuff from 73 to about 79, 80, every year, it's almost like the bar was raised. The musical palette expanded. The songs became, in some cases, more personal. Tell us about that evolution.
Yeah, you grow. You know, you grow as an individual, as a songwriter, you know, because a lot of times I write from what's happening in life in general, you know. And so you grow as you grow in knowledge and wisdom. You grow with your band members. You know, the more you play together, the more you tour together, because you grow from touring too. You learn so much when you're playing this music live. You know, you learn and have a feel for what works and what maybe doesn't work as well. And so with that growth, that makes the next project quite different than the last one, because you got more, you know, more stuff to say, you know, because you already said what you said last year. So now let's go to the next level. And that makes everything, and it keeps it fresh, you know. And even from back then till now, you know, there's been a growth period from being with people like Prince and other people that, you know, contributed to the Raise Up album. Hmm. And I hope to continue to grow. My ears and my heart is always open to learn.
Well, we're ready to listen.
Yeah.
But you brought
I was just going to say, you can hear that on Raise Up on the album, but specifically on Raise Up the song. You can hear those kind of more electronic drum machine sounds. And I mean, even though you had elements of that yourself in GCS, you can, there's also a Prince influence now, at least on that song to me.
Well, of course. I mean, he's my neighbor and my good friend. He's like my brother. Of course you're going to hear that. He has to rub off on me, and I have to rub off on him. You know, that's how friends do. You know, people do that even who aren't musicians. They start having some of the same phrases. You know, and start to think alike and can start to finish each other's sentences sometimes. And you know what the other person is saying, you know, getting ready to say.
Yeah,
you know, some music is like that too. You start to influence one another, which is a good thing.
Hmm. Well, you led me straight to the next question, which is a directly Prince-related question. If you can remember, back early 80s, there was this young artist called Prince, started releasing albums like Controversy, 1999, Purple Rain. Can you remember any impressions you had of him back then, like way before you even met him. You would have heard and heard the music, but what was your impressions back then?
Well, I heard what they were playing on the radio, mostly. You know, I never got a chance to meet him. Yeah, I never got a chance to really meet him. We were both at a Warner Brothers picnic they had for all the Warner Brothers artists. And we met briefly in passing. But I really didn't really get to know him until, until we hooked up 15, 16 years ago. Mm. And that's when we really got to know each other. So I really know more about him since then till now, more so than back in the earlier days. But the things that I heard back in the day, you know, of course, all the hits, you know, everybody liked them because it was good music, you know, and that's why they were hits, you know. So I'm on that same page too.
You didn't hear some songs and go, "Oh, that bass line sounds a bit like something I've done before."
Well, you know, by that time, you know, unlike the early Sly and the Family Stone days, by the time of the 80s, I mean, there were so many bass players that had began to, you know, play my thumping and plucking style on slap bass, because that just became the way to play. Mm. So when I hear something on his album or anybody's album, it didn't really catch me by surprise. I mean, if it's a funky song, you know, you kind of almost expect it.
Yeah.
You know, so it's not like, wow, you know. So when I heard him doing, you know, licks that were familiar to my ears, it didn't set me back, because that's what everybody else was pretty much doing too.
Almost expected.
Which is, makes me feel good. Yeah, I mean, you know, to hear the other people doing your stuff, but that's the biggest compliment someone can really pay you, is to, you know, imitate you in some way.
Yeah, I mean, every time, you know, I hear Marcus Miller or Flea or all these kind of guys, Stanley Clarke, Wooten, the list goes on. It's just like, it's so obvious where what records they were listening to and when they were coming up, because your sound and imprint, or should I say fingerprint, is all over them.
Thumbprint.
Thumbprint, that's right.
Yeah.
Thumbprint, to be precise.
You know, what would happen in the earlier days, see, when songs like Thank You for Let Me Be Myself, I'll take that for an example. It's other songs too. But a lot of bass players, they heard the music, but they didn't know what I was doing. As Marcus mentioned in an interview I heard him do, some folks weren't even quite sure if it was a bass or what it was, you know. And so for a long time, there weren't a lot of bass players copying me, because they didn't know what I was doing. And then videos weren't as popular, you know, back then either, and TV shows were limited. But then as we start to do more TV shows like Ed Sullivan and Dick Cavett and other shows, people start seeing exactly what I was doing. And as we played more and more concerts, you know, musicians, bass players would come and they would see what I was doing. And it's like, oh, that's what he's doing. And then little by little, little by little over the years, then you start hearing more bass players playing like me, particularly if they were covering one of our songs. You pretty much had to play my style to play Thank You or Dance to the Music or some of the other songs. Then as time passed, then other bands started having their bass players play like me on their original music. So not just to cover our music, but their original music. You had groups like Earth, Wind and Fire and, you know, other groups that started leaning toward, you know, the style of playing I was playing.
Uh-huh. Just quickly on Prince again, you guys have jammed many times over the years.
And
as you say, he was schooled on your music, and it was probably, you know, trying to figure out your bass lines when he was coming up. Can you tell us anything about learning the bass parts in Prince's music whenever you've stepped out on stage with him?
Well, that's the thing about that, is because he was raised up on my music, some of the bass lines, even though they weren't the exact same bass patterns that I had played maybe on one of my records, it would be a similarity to it, because it's my style of playing. So it was, it would always be something that I could relate to, you know. So basically all I'd have to do is learn the song, not concentrate so much on the bass line, but basically the changes to the song, you know, because it's his song, is his pattern, you know, when to go to the bridge and what changes and so forth. But as far as the bass playing, the style would always be pretty much similar to, you know, what I already do.
So Prince, when you were like, if you did a rehearsal, Prince wasn't like, no, Larry, that's not how you do it. Do it this way.
No, I don't mind correction at all. I have no problems with being positive, told, you know, what to do and where a change should go, you know, because, you know, when my mother and I worked together, I just take you back briefly, you know, half the night I'm playing the lead. So I knew how to be in the background. I knew how to be up front. When I joined Fine Family Stone, you know, we all sung lead. We all were featured at different times on a lot of the songs and in the shows. So I knew how to be in the background and I knew how to take the lead. And same thing with my band. So I have no problem being in the background and I have no problem, you know, learning other people's music. You know, I've toured, with the Crusaders. That's the first time I ever went to Japan was with the Crusaders. And, I've toured with Stanley Clark. We went to Brazil, did around 10 cities over there, and different people. So I have no problem learning other people's stuff. It's fun. So I can be in the background. I can be up front because I have fun either way.
I've actually noticed Prince a few times. He actually prefers to just be a guy in a band. He doesn't always want to be the front guy. You see him turn up at other people's gigs now and then. He'll just stand in the back and play guitar for a while. And, you know, he's not Prince at a Prince concert. He's just a guy in a band.
Exactly.
And he seems to love doing that every now and then just to get out of the spotlight.
Exactly. You know, and he doesn't have an ego trip to, you know, prevent him from doing that. You know, he's a very humble person. As great as he is, you know, he retains his humility and has no problem stepping in, you know, in the background and out of the spotlight. And, you know, that's a beautiful thing because not everyone can do that. You know, some folks, the light always got to be on them.
Yeah, I think he's gotten better. I think he wasn't always so humble though.
He's gotten
maybe since he met you, a lot better.
Yeah, I can only speak for the last 15, 16 years. I don't know much about before the end.
we have our tongue firmly in our cheek, Larry. I mean, we know Prince has listened to our show on occasion, and we actually met him briefly for a few hours 3 or 4 years ago, and we've spoken about about this sort of stuff and had a good time. So, but one thing that just quickly popped into my head was about something we spoke about earlier with regards to you playing the bass, you know, in GCS, and then also you've got that mic hooked up to. Is it your strap or is it actually the bass? I can never think of that.
It's plugged into my bass.
Yeah, and I just thought about the influence of your position in Graham's Interstation and some other notable bass players. Immediately, they come to my mind. The likes of even someone like a Sting, Michelle Nigricello, Esperanza Spalding. They may not be directly obvious influences, but I think there's a lot there. As a comparison, it's a unique position you're in.
You know, I really appreciate you saying that. Kind of like I said earlier, though, you know, I don't really think about it. I just kind of like put the bass on automatic pilot, and my biggest focus is really on entertaining the audience and feeding off the audience, and kind of like almost more of a singer sometimes, you know, focusing more on that, you know, and I think that's what some of the other artists do. I've seen Esperanza Spalding in person, you know, on more than one occasion, and she kind of does that too. I can kind of see her basis on autopilot, and she's wailing away with her voice, you know, and it's, you know, it's a blessing to be able to do that. You know, I guess I should consider it, you know, as a gift, because maybe it's just not natural for everybody to do that. To me, it seems natural, but you know. But I've actually had this conversation with a bass player before, and when he stopped thinking about it for a while, he was playing and singing. I saw it happen. I saw it happen. He was playing and singing and hit a few steps too.
Dancing and singing.
All he ever wanted to do.
Yeah.
Do you have a particular favorite Prince song or Prince album that stands out for you that you really like to play or listen to?
Oh, no, it's just so much, you know, that I've been exposed to in, you know, over the last 15 years, you know, so much stuff that has been played on shows, but so much stuff I've heard in the studio. I don't know if anybody else will ever hear it. It's just so much, and he's just capable of doing so many types of music, you know, and not just on the guitar. You know, he'll get on the piano and just, whew, incredible, you know. So I don't have a particular album, but just him as a person, as an overall musician, you know, and not just a guitar player, but, you know, as a multi-talented musician. He'll get on the drums and wear out some drums and the keyboards and the guitar and the bass, as you know.
Yeah. And see, that's the thing. You get some people, they're a great guitarist and they're average at everything else, but he can do almost everything except maybe horns, yes. I think, and he can do it pretty damn well, which
yeah.
is amazing.
Yeah, and if you can't play it, he can arrange it and tell you what would sound best to play.
Yeah, yeah. I've got a bass question. Uh-huh. Most of the time we see you, you've got that white bass, but how many bass guitars do you have?
I've been playing
don't say
Moon.
One.
No, I've been playing my Moon bass. I helped design that about 30 years ago with the Moon Corporation in Japan, and basically checked out all the basses, what they were doing, and then you know, basses I had played in the past, and just try to pretty much take the best of what they had to offer, put it with everything that I would like to have in a bass, and came up with the Moon bass. And it's pretty much been my main axe, you know, for the last 30 years. Yeah.
So you took all the things you wanted to Moon, and they put it all together, and that's what they came up with.
Well, yeah, because they weren't a large company. So they could take the time to give me, you know, individualized attention.
Yeah.
And that's what they did. And they were looking for ideas too. So they were very open, you know, so it was a very good relationship that, you know, gave birth to one of my favorite instruments that I've played over the years.
Larry, we all know you can play the bass. And if you don't, there's something wrong with you, but we know you can play the bass. But have you ever thought, you know, mid show, you just jump on the guitar for a while or play piano, bit of Chopin or Bach or something in there?
Yeah, I have, because on a lot of my records, which you probably already noticed, I play a lot of the instruments myself. A lot of my records, I play keyboards and drums and guitar. And but I haven't really done it on stage. But look out, never know.
There's an idea, keep that.
I haven't thought about it.
Oh, just on the vocal tip as well, we've talked a lot about bass playing and music in general, but the other aspect obviously is your incredibly well-recognized vocals. I mean, you know, with the bass and the baritone go really well together, I think, and it creates a unique sound.
Yeah. What kind of it's a Larry Graham song when you hear that.
Definitely. There's no two ways about it. And I was just wondering, what kind of singers did you kind of come up on when, you know, as you were coming up as a musician, and maybe who do you listen to now?
Vocally? Well, yep. When my mother and I started working together, playing nightclubs and lounges and stuff, you get paid a salary, but you make a lot of extra money on tips. And there's a little tip jar on top of the piano. And when a person makes a request, if you know the song, then they might drop a 10 or 20 or something up in that tip jar.
Uh-huh.
And you end up with a nice little taste, you know, that night. So all the male vocalists that were popular during that time, Frank Sinatra, Billy Eckstine, Nat King Cole, Ray Charles, Tony Bennett, you know, all those songs, all those artists, when people request songs by them, then it would be on me. to fulfill the request. And then all the female vocalists that were popular at the time, my mother would, you know, fill those. And she had this great big, thick book. It's called a fake book, where it doesn't give you all of the sheet music, but it gives you the melody and the chords, chord mm-hmm. structure and lyrics. So you can get like a lot of songs in one book. And so we pretty much made it a point to fill every request, you know, not only because we love to play, but it also meant money for us too. Mm. And so I, during that time period, I was singing like everything. And my voice had already changed then too, because before then, like in junior high school, I was singing a lot of Frankie Lyman stuff. My voice was high. You know, I could sing his songs in his key. Uh-huh. And then one morning I woke up and it just changed. I didn't even go through the squeaky thing.
Was that around the time of the five riffs?
Yeah. Okay. You know, and it just, and the five riffs I played guitar. And, so it just switched, you know. One morning I just get up, morning mom, you know. And, so
she's
when my
like,
mother
oh,
and
no,
I. Oh
no, you can't sing the Frankie Lyman songs now.
No, that was so over. So then, by the time I got to Sly and the Family Stone, you know, I'm used to singing all these ballads and everything from working with my mom. So the first song he had me sing on, one of the first two songs, I don't know if you're familiar with the album A Whole New Thing.
Oh yeah.
Cause that came out before Dance to the Music.
Yeah. Mm.
And on that album, I'm singing a song called Bad Risk, but a ballad called Let Me Hear It From You. And that came from him being aware of hearing me in the club when he asked me to join the band, hearing me not only playing the bass, but singing too. So he had me sing that ballad, which he very well could have done it himself because he has a baritone voice too. But he got me to sing it. And, you know, so since those days, with my mom, I've been focusing not just on my instrument, but on my voice too.
Larry, do you have a favorite funk song or favorite funk album? And you can't choose your own here. This is something that you've heard and you thought, man, I really wanted to write that.
Oh man, there's so many out there. Of course, I love a lot of the early Stevie stuff. Mm. You know, Talking Book and Songs in the Key of Life and. I like some of the early Chaka Khan and Rufus stuff.
Oh, yeah.
You had a chance to hook up with Tony Madden from Rufus?
Yes, I did. Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, he did a video with me in my studio, kind of like an instructional video.
I've seen that. That was one of the first things that I've seen of you. I saw it on a BBC documentary called Rock School, and you guys were playing.
That's what it was.
Yeah, yeah. That's Fox great. That's what, wait, I was actually going to ask you that question. Do you have any more plans to do any more sort of tutorial or instructional videos?
I really would like to. I'd like to hook up with the right person to work with to do that. Because since the time I did that one in Japan, a funk bass attack, there's been so many requests to do something again, mm-hmm. you know. I would very much like to find the right person to get with and do that.
I read somewhere not that long ago that you were involved with a project. I think it's a documentary about you, your life. And I was just wondering what's happening with that. Is it completed? What's happening there? Cause I think I read it was almost done.
Yeah. But you know, things like that, you can always add to them as
you go, yeah.
Yeah, it's not done until it's finally released. That's and then you can't do anything else to it, you know. But up until that time, because, you know, day to day, you know, life keeps on, you know, changing and something can happen, you know, next week or tomorrow that needs to be part of that, you know, part of that. So
yeah.
It's ongoing until it's released.
Well, because when you come to Sydney, you're going to meet us, so that's got to be in there, of course.
Oh, there you go. There you go.
That's a whole chapter on its own.
Yeah, I can already feel that's going to be quite a wonderful experience.
I can't wait to watch that. Whenever it comes out, it's going to be great.
Well, speaking of chapters, have you ever thought of writing, say, a book about your music or your experiences?
That, yes, yes. I've been asked about that too a number of times, because I've been through a lot of different phases of my life, going from working with my mother to Sly and Family Stone to Graham Central Station and my solo career to working with Prince to now. It's been like a lot, you know. So, yeah, I definitely would have a lot to write about. So that's something else that I would like to do too.
And speaking of writing, obviously Raise Up, the album, is a fairly recent release, and it sounds like you guys are playing some material from that, and the response has been incredibly positive. Are you also thinking of recording some new music at some point in the future? I mean, I'm sure that's always a possibility.
Recording some new music in the future? Oh, of course. Oh, yeah, definitely. Because sometimes I'll write stuff at home, and like I've done in the past, I'll play all their instruments myself, and then maybe teach, you know, parts to other band members or get their contribution to the song. And when we go into the, you know, studio and play it all together. So some things I've done by myself and then go in the studio and do it live to get that feel.
I was going to ask you about that, because I was going to say, well, have you ever thought about documenting, you know, this version of Graham Central Station as a band within a live album?
DVD, but, live show.
Yeah, but, I mean, the more I think about it, the album itself already sounds so live and vibrant anyway, so maybe people just have to come to the shows.
Yeah. The show is very closely related to the album, you know, and feel. Not necessarily always the same songs. But I try to structure the show kind of like the way the album is structured, and structure the album like I structure my shows, and try to tell a complete story, you know, in one sitting.
Did you record it analog out of interest?
Yeah, some of the stuff I hit tape first.
Oh, wow.
To get and, the warmth.
Yeah, it's nothing like, you know, it's nothing like hitting that tape. Yeah. And then, of course, if you go digital from there for editing purposes, you've captured the sound, at least.
You've got it, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and you can really hear that. There's plenty of tracks on the, plenty of songs on the new album where you can really hear it. I feel like your bass was really kind of, it's in the front of the mix more so than on, even on some of the old GCS material or you know, CDs and,
yeah.
So that's really pleasing, because when you put those headphones on and you can just listen to that crystal clear bass, and it's got that warmth. It's not cold and digital, you know, the way a lot of
things
are recorded.
Yeah, exactly.
When they were mixing, Larry got in there and he's like, more bass, more bass. Bass out the front.
kind of true, but I was really more concentrating on the quality of the sound. And one advantage of recording now compared to maybe back in the 70s or 60s even is the equipment. There's a lot more technology to work with now, you know. And so back in the day, I'm sure it wasn't just me, but a lot of musicians may have found it a little frustrating to try to get things to sound exactly like you hear it in your head, because equalizers weren't as sophisticated and all kind of other gear that's out there now. Even editing itself, you know, it was about taking a razor blade out and
slicing
that tape. Yeah, carefully, you know, hanging up on the wall in case you need it later, you know. And whereas now you can go in and experiment, and if you don't like that, you can put it right back to what it was, you know. But at the same time, still capture the warmth on tape first before you even send it to Pro Tools or whatever you choose to use. But yeah, you know, I can zero in more on the bass so that it's not necessarily louder as much as it is more isolated within the frequencies that is being taken up, you know, by the bass. You can kind of zero in on that. And not just bass, I mean, any instrument now. I mean, today's world, you know, you can do a lot more than you could do back in the day.
You got to keep in mind, though, this is it's a Larry Graham album. It's a GCS album. People are there. They want to hear that bass. You can't bury that in the mix. It's got to be right up there.
Oh. Oh, no, no. I definitely kept that in mind because I have people throwing it back at me, you know, when I get to the shows, like a little, you know, flying saucer. Here's your album back.
More bass. See, I've got the CD version of Raised Up, and I know what you mean, Larry, because the dynamic range that you guys managed to capture, even on the CD version, is so wide. Yeah. So I'm now thinking, I've got to get the vinyl version of it now to get it even well, maybe not wider, but warmer.
Yeah, there is a difference. Well, you know, there is always be a difference between vinyl and CDs.
Yeah.
But I try to get it as similar as possible, you know, and try to get that CD sound in as warm as the album, because obviously people are going to buy more CDs than vinyl. And more downloads and stuff. It's going to be more in a digital domain, more so than vinyl. So I really try to get it sounding as close, which basically is trying to get it to sound as much in the studio, get it sounding as much as you can, you know, can, like what you're hearing in your head. And I'm, you know, I was blessed to work with some great engineers too. And that always helps when you can communicate, because sometimes I might not technically know what it is I'm trying to get, but if I can explain it, and if the engineer can respond, and then I can say, yeah, that's it. Or a little more of that, a little less that, you know. So I was blessed to have some great engineers too.
And the horns sound really bright and kind of, they've got a live feel. I mean, the whole thing's just got a live feel. What's the horn section? So I read somewhere that Millfield horns, is that them?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Very, very, very nice, man. And he's, they've played with us before, on some gigs. I think the last time was the last time we played in Copenhagen, but he's played with us on a number. They have on a number of shows in Europe. No U.S. shows yet.
Oh, they can wait. They've got enough shows. You got to get down here first.
Yeah, there you go. There you go. And, no, your friend that's missing. He plays sax or trumpet.
Trumpet.
Trumpet. Okay.
Trumpet and keyboards and a few things. Yeah.
At the same time. Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh.
Yeah, there's a big Prince influence with our friend. And actually, I say Prince influence, but it's really also a Larry Graham influence, because as much as Prince has been given a lot of hype, I think, and you know, a lot of the advertising and marketing around him was always, you know, Prince the one-man band. But really, I mean, you were doing the same sort of stuff, you know, a decade earlier.
Or two.
That's it. I mean, that's interesting. How is it like sitting in a room and just doing it all yourself?
Actually, I count it as a blessing. Because a lot of my creativity comes at times when there's no one else around. So I can just go and at least lay down all the parts. If it's not what's going to be, you know, on the record, I can at least lay down the parts. And sometimes I've laid down parts that are keepers. Because sometimes you capture something and you really can't play it the exact same way again.
You got the feel.
And so I've done that a number of times and just leave it. But yes, it's a blessing to be able to play the different instruments. Like, you know, and again, that comes from growing up, not knowing exactly what I wanted to play, but I knew I wanted to be a musician because my father played guitar, my mother played piano, and both were singers. And so I knew I was going to be in the music, but I wasn't sure what I was going to end up on. So the good thing about that is I kind of like just tried them all out, and that helped me later on. I wasn't playing it back then that I'm doing this so one day I can play all the stuff on my records. I didn't know why I was doing it back then, but it was just the joy of learning music, period.
Well, look where it got you. You ended up on the Peach and Black podcast. How good is that? Pinnacle.
There you go. And I tell you what else was really cool too is a lot of the schools. I don't know how it is in Australia, but a lot of the music programs in the States have been cut, you know, and a lot of the kids don't have instruments as readily available as we had growing up. And I think that's major. I mean, if you wanted to play trumpet, you know, then the school gave you a trumpet and free lessons. I mean, it came with schooling. And if you wanted to play the drums, you had all those instruments. Whereas now it's kind of a major issues in quite a number of schools. And then so another thing I think was great growing up is there were a lot of places to play, clubs and other venues that you could play a lot and hone your skill before you were put out there on the big stage. So when people came to see you, you know, you pretty much had quite a bit of experience under your belt in playing live. It wasn't like, you know, you just were thrown out there and do your best, you know.
But we had a lot. There's not that many places where you can do that anymore. They don't even want you on the stage unless you've done 50 shows. So
yeah,
how do
you
get that experience if no one's going to let you to get out there?
Well, I think more and more people, you know, are getting into the concept of, you know, garage banding it, you know, getting together and playing amongst each other, you know, and it's not necessarily for an audience, but honing your skill, playing together. If it's not a venue, you create one make it happen, play together. So by the time you do play in front of folks, you know, that's not the learning training ground there at the gig. You already did that.
Yeah.
Now you're coming in pain.
Now you got to deal with the stage fright.
and
again, I mean, that's the great thing about coming to seeing you guys and you know, I mean, not only your band, but also, you know, talking about you and your history, and you know, you've been there, done that, and you've gone through the ringer, really, and now when people come to a Larry Graham and GCS show these days, I don't want to put the words in your mouth, but to me, it's I won't say rare, because there are still some folk, you know, people that I think were around in your era, the GCS era at least, that are still doing it. But man, for anyone that's listening, and there will be a lot of people listening to this show, you got to get yourself there. I mean, everyone's probably already got tickets to it anyway. But anyone that doesn't and thinking twice, don't think twice.
We are so. We're pumped. We're looking forward to it. You know, it's going to be, because I was there before, but as you know, with Prince, but I've never had my band, Graham Central Station, there. And this is something I've been looking forward to for a long time. I would say since the last time I was there and played with Prince. Man, it'd be great if I could bring my band back here. And now it's happening.
So this is really your Australian debut. You're starting all over again.
Yeah. I mean, except for not from scratch.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
you get a bit of experience there, but for some people, they might not know anything about you. They'll just turn up at the basement, and you're going to just blow them away. It'll be great.
That's the incredible thing. I mean, Bluesfest is such an it's a huge lineup, and it's a very diverse lineup. And I've already spoken to a few people. You know, we get in touch with some of the fans and promoters and people within the music industry in Australia. And there's so many people on that lineup. But I'll tell you, a lot of them are talking about getting to the stage where Graham Central Station are going to be at, because there's just a feel. I think you guys really, really put on an incredible show, and that energy is palpable. You know, it's addictive for people who love live music. So.
Infectious, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, we love playing. We love what we do. You know, my whole band is like that, so I'm grateful to be surrounded by such a great bunch of musicians.
Great.
And you're doing a lot of shows too. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, I mean, it's 4 days in a row, really.
Yeah. Yeah. We are going to be throwing down pretty hard there.
Yeah.
But the good thing is, we are well rested. We're not coming off another tour, you know, like now. You know, everybody's been home and, you know, getting a chance to be with their families and do everything else that you do in life. So we're coming well rested.
Fresh,
you know. And Australia is our first hit. So you're going to get the fresh GCS.
Are you going to get any relaxing time while you're here, or you're leaving straight away after the shows?
I think we pretty much have to leave because we're heading to China. After we leave Australia, we're going to Beijing and Shanghai, and then we hit Japan and Tokyo and Osaka, and then come home. But my whole thing is to open up the door for Graham Central Station to be invited back.
Oh yeah.
And then next time, you know, we'll be able to, you know, come on our own. And you know, you'll spend some time after and hang out.
You're always welcome, Larry. Always.
Oh, well, thank you.
I think we just about run out of questions, huh?
I think we have. Yeah, so again, thanks so very, very much for your time. I know time is precious,
Well, you're more than welcome, and look forward to seeing you when we get there.
Oh, we'll be there.
All right.
We'll have our big pow sign just in case you forgot.
Yeah, so, do that.
See you soon.
Bye-bye. You're welcome.
All right. There you have it. That was our exclusive Peach and Black interview with Larry Graham. Hope you enjoyed it. We certainly did. It was great to talk to, you know, the funk bass legend himself in such an open and relaxed conversation. So those tour dates again for anyone that missed out earlier on in the show, Larry Graham and Graham Central Station will be playing the Byron Bay Bluesfest on April 18th and 19th. They'll also be doing two shows at The Basement in Sydney on April 20th and 21st. Peach and Black will also be there for that, so just a little bit of extra incentive to get your get your bodies to those shows.
Or disincentive.
And, of course, finalizing their tour in Australia at the Corner Hotel in Melbourne, April 23rd. And, look, Bluesfest is going to be incredible. The lineup for Bluesfest is unbelievable anyway, and adding Larry Graham and GCS to that is just going to – they're really going to tear the roof off. You know, even with all those other great musicians, I think they are going to be the act to see there. And, you know, the Basement and the Corner Hotel, these are small, intimate venues, people, and they've got a lot of character and a lot of, you know, the atmosphere is great in these places. And I could just imagine, I can't wait, guys. There'll be plenty of sweaty bodies moving around, lots of towel waving and, and perspiring and funkifying and all that kind of good stuff.
It's only a few weeks to go.
That's right. It's coming up, y'all. Hope to see you there. Like I said, we're going to be there in Sydney. And an extra special thank you once again to Mr. Larry Graham for giving us your time, sir, and for answering some of our left field questions and for being a great guest on the show. So I hope to see you there. Can't wait for these shows.
Right. Okay, here we go. This is the big thing. Let's go, MC.
All right. So for the final little announcement of, well, final.
The final pow!
The final big announcement on this show to do with Larry Graham and Graham Central Station's shows in Australia. Please listen very carefully if you are from Sydney or Melbourne and are attending either the Sydney or Melbourne shows.
Or you could be from Perth, but you are attending the Sydney or Melbourne show.
That's true. So, very good correction, Captain. As long as you, the listener, are attending either the Sydney or Melbourne shows and you are a ticket holder, key point here, ladies and gentlemen, you must already have tickets or in the next few days must have purchased tickets. So you must be a ticket holder. What you can do is send us an email directly to Peach and Black at
peachandblackpodcastofficial@gmail.com.
And player, once again, that email address is
peachandblackpodcastofficial@gmail.com.
That's right. And send us an email. You must be a ticket holder, ladies and gentlemen. Send us an email to that email address with your name, with obviously your email address or contact details, and contact details.
The show that you're attending.
The show that you're attending are in either Sydney or in Melbourne.
But also the date you're attending. We need to know which one.
And what that will do is enter you into a random draw for a chance to win a ticket upgrade of your Larry Graham and GCS concert experience. We can't say any more than that, but if you're a ticket holder, you'd be crazy not to send us an email. That's all I'll say.
Well, see, this upgrade, you know, this isn't even available. You cannot buy this ticket.
That's right, Captain. This is not a ticket for sale.
No.
So if you're a ticket holder,
you cannot buy this. We are giving away tickets that don't even exist.
That is awesome.
You cannot buy these tickets. You can only win these tickets through Peach and Black Podcast.
And if you're in Sydney, it involves us too. That's the price.
And we've already said too much. We have already said too much, ladies and gentlemen, for all of our listeners. All of our Italian and Dutch and English and German and Swedish listeners, I know you're probably thinking, what is MC talking about? What are player and captain wasting our time? We want to hear Larry Graham. Well, put on the record. We're talking about these Australian shows, and this is just a little segment for our Australian listeners. If none of that made sense, rewind the podcast and listen to it again. If you're a ticket holder, send us an email if you're going to Sydney or to Melbourne, and you're going to enter a draw for something pretty special. So, let's leave it at that. Thank you for your company once again. It's been a pleasure as always. What more can I say? We're about to get real, real funky. See you later.
Hey, where's Toe Jam?
Hey guys, Toe Jam here. I'm ready to go. I'm so excited, I can't wait for this. This is going to be awesome. Larry Graham, we're going to be speaking to Larry Graham. Can you believe it? Oh, I can't wait. Come on guys, where is everyone? Hello? Come on, I've got my fedora hat and my stick-on mo. I'm all ready to go. Come on, this is going to be awesome. Where is everyone? Larry Graham, come on! Hello?